Plants belong to another universe, a silent and seemingly simple world. They make food from sunshine, which in turn feeds the animal kingdom. But what if plants were keeping something from us? What if they have minds? What if they are intelligent? Scientists are asking these very questions. Do they perceive their environment? Do they have a memory? Could they have a nervous system? To these men and women, the great divide between the plant and animal world is not that great at all. Our investigation into the mind of plants begins with a mystery, a murder mystery. In the late 1980s, a serial killer was stalking the Limpopo savannah. At the time, there was a severe drought. The country was devastated. Water holes had dried up, and food became scarce. Only the tough and widely spread acacia provided any sign of hope to large herbivores, such as the kudu. These beautiful and robust animals could nibble around the tree's defensive spikes, plucking its small green leaves. Death by starvation seemed averted. The hard times could be survived. But then something strange began to happen. Large numbers of healthy kudus suddenly dropped dead. Thousands littered the landscape. The deaths continued for months with no clues as to why. The kudus lived on game reserves and were an important source of income to their owners and the tourist industry. The cost was high for both animals and people.
It's very distressful to me to see such beautiful animals just lying dead for no reason. So I decided I've got the time and I'm going to find out what it is.
I found another dead kudu.
We've lost 34 kudus. And the strange thing is that they die and they don't look bad.
We were very worried at that stage on this situation there. And that's why we've spent the money to try and determine, because the autopsies are expensive.
The veterinarian, through the autopsy, couldn't say anything. He couldn't find anything wrong with the animal. He made a suggestion we should actually look further into the process and see if we can't get any university involved.
The job of detective fell on this man, Wouter van Hoven, a distinguished conservation biologist and specialist in great African herbivores.
The thing that was most puzzling in this whole thing of kudus is that there were mortalities on certain ranches, but on other ranches there was no mortalities. And you know, we couldn't understand this because, you know, game ranches are fenced in. And the ranches are very much similar. Some ranches, they die, some ranches, they don't die. So then we started making a survey, and what we found is that there's a direct relationship between the number of kudu on the ranch per unit of size and the number of mortalities. So mortality was density related.
It wasn't much to go on. The more the kudu stayed as a group, the more chance they had of dying. It was clear that predators did not kill them. There were no obvious marks on their bodies. Finding the cause of deaths would need further investigation. Van Hoven arrived with a fully equipped mobile lab and a team of students to help him carry out a series of autopsies.
I looked at some of them post-mortem because we couldn't find any diseases, parasites, nothing of that.
Van Hoven then focused his research on the dead animal's stomach content. Kudus digest their food in a way similar to cows, needing the natural fermentation process to help it break down plant matter. The first post-mortem analyses showed something very odd.
I looked at the intestines, and particularly in the rumen, and had a look at the efficiency of fermentation, the rate of fermentation. And that was the next clue, that on the farm where the animals died, the rate of fermentation was lower than the neighbor which had less kudu, and there was no mortalities on his farm. Something was influencing the rate of fermentation. Now, what could that possibly be?
As the research continued, they found something even stranger. All the dead kudus had unusually high doses of tannin in their bodies. Tannins are molecules that some plants use as a chemical defense to fight off parasites and leaf-eating insects. Plants normally only produce small quantities of tannin, and large herbivores can just flush this low toxin out of their system through the liver. But the tannin levels were far too high for the kudus to handle, resulting in the slowing down of the fermentation process and the animal's ability to digest its food, with fatal consequences. The deadly tannin had to come from plants, as it only occurs naturally in them. But which ones? And how or why would any plant produce enough tannin to kill animals on such a massive scale? We shouldn't be too surprised to hear that plants kill animals. Unwary creatures can find themselves in an upside-down world where what they normally eat, eats them. Carnivorous plants have evolved elaborate traps, some with sticky fingers. Others have snapping jaws or slippery slides to catch prey. This is how they've adapted to living in poor soil and compensate for nutritional deficiencies. They've even pushed the limits of refinement by growing their sexual organs far from their stomachs in order to spare pollinating insects. Jean-Jacques Labat is a specialist in carnivorous plants. His collection in southwest France is unique in Europe.
There are about 650 species of carnivorous plants throughout the world. The only places where you won't find them are the poles and deserts. The most fascinating of them is the Darlingtonia. The Darlingtonia, also called the cobra lily, has evolved remarkable urn or trumpet-shaped traps. These urns, which stick out like cobra heads, have an appendage shaped like a mustache or a forked tongue. An insect is attracted by the color and nectar. It lands on the plant and climbs up the length of the tongue. It comes to a hole underneath the dome. Feeding on the nectar, the insect loses its footing and falls to the bottom. There's no water at the bottom, so it will take off again. And there, look, it's fantastic. False windows due to different thicknesses of its cell walls. The insect believes that the light shows him the way out, and for hours it will bump into those fake windows. It will never find the exit that is actually under its feet. After a while, the exhausted insect falls to the bottom, where the plant slowly digests it. A brilliant strategy from the plant world.
Carnivorous plants are the exception to the rule. In general, the question of who is superior is simply answered, and the line between the two worlds is clear. Plants make their own food using sunlight through a process called photosynthesis, while the animal world feeds on them. We don't just classify plants by the way they make food, but also by movement. Plants are fixed, whereas animals run, crawl, swim, or fly to feed. Yet in the world of single-celled organisms, this line is blurred. Some can act as both an animal and a plant, hunt for food, and use photosynthesis. Today, biologists believe that plants don't share the same evolutionary origins, separating mushrooms, mosses, and others into different kingdoms. Botanist Professor Francis Hallet specializes in the structure of trees and the ecology of tropical rainforests. For Professor Hallet, the world of plants is a misunderstood kingdom full of wondrous treasures.
The Americans have sequenced human DNA, 26,000 genes. The problem is that a few years later, we sequenced the genome of rice, 50,000 genes. That gave us a cold chill, and many biologists thought we would have to abandon the idea that the more genes an organism had, the more evolved it was. Axel Kahn, a colleague and human genome geneticist, told us, no, don't drop this idea. The more a living creature evolves, the more genes it has. This simply proves that rice is more evolved than us. Try spending all winter with your feet in cold water, feeding only from the sun's rays and carbon dioxide. Well, you couldn't. And the reason is that you don't have the right genetic equipment. You don't have enough genes. Plants and animals are not in a race. We can't say that plants have overtaken us. In reality, it's a strange kind of race, because one goes left and the other goes right. Their strategies are inverse. So now we have to recognize that on their journey, plants have gone much further than we have on ours.
Plants and animals have evolved alongside one another. Plants may feed animals, but in return, they ask to be pollinated and have their seeds dispersed. They've developed an arsenal of biological weapons to protect themselves, but they've also created a treasure trove of seductive powers. Their variety, beauty, and perfumes are compensation for an adult life fixed to the ground. Their only fleeting moment of freedom are as seedlings, falling to the ground, or floating through the air. They've learned and mastered some important rules of survival: adaptation and cooperation.
It's quite easy to say that thanks to evolution, the living systems become more and more clever or more and more intelligent, while intelligence could be defined in various ways.
We generally consider intelligence as a combination of things: the perception of our environment and the ability to react to it, having a memory, being able to communicate, interact socially, and having a brain to coordinate it all. Worldwide, a small group of scientists are at the forefront of this controversial branch of science. The University of Bonn in Germany is a leader in the research of plant intelligence. Here they're exploring one of the fundamental qualities for intelligence: the ability to perceive the environment.
The results we had last year, combined with the work of our colleagues, have shown that plants can interact in many different ways with their environment.
Professor Volkmann conducts his experiments using simple techniques to unlock the secrets of plant perception and intelligence.
There are several plants, like pea and beans, developing tendrils to find some support to come up to the light and to the air. We are using pea plants like this. Here we have two pea plants. And when we are stimulating these tendrils in such a way by a wooden stick 3, 4, or 5 times, then these tendrils will move and respond in direction of the stick in spite of the fact that we removed this stick.
The pea plant's outer surface is covered with sensors that send a signal to the cells below. The stimulated cells grow less rapidly than the outer ones, causing it to twist around whatever it touches. This is what allows the pea plant to grow in all directions, stretching out, feeling the world around it, grabbing hold, creating the foundations for the rest of the plant to follow. Plants sense their environment. This is true of growing pea plants, as it is of their flesh-eating cousins. Carnivorous plants are a little more complex. To ensure the plant captures something edible, the insect must first activate 2 fine hairs inside the trap before it closed. Another fast-moving plant is the sensitive. Water pressure against the cell walls keeps its leaves stiff. When it's pinched or stroked, the water pressure drops and the plant quickly sags. The exact reason why is not known, but the sudden movement from a touch could be a defense mechanism, frightening insects that land on it. Fast-moving plants are uncommon. We mostly see them as static. But this is only because we look at them through human time.
What are the animals that live the longest? I think it's the giant turtles. They live 3 centuries. This seems a long time to us. But for a plant, it's no time at all. There are millions of 3,000-year-old plants. They can live much longer than that. For example, a Proteacea from Tasmania, the King's Holly, can live for 43,000 years. And in fact, this plant is in its youth and has no intention of dying. All this is to say that time runs differently for plants than for animals.
Scientific studies about plants began less than 100 years ago. In the 1920s, Indian botanist Jagadish Chandra Bose tried to show that plants not only had sensations, but some kind of consciousness. He was well ahead of his time, using electricity to stimulate plants. He launched pioneering research into plant growth and plant reaction to electromagnetic waves. In the 1970s, Soviet researchers flirted with sensitive plants. The results were spectacular. In their experiments, they managed to anesthetize plants with chloroform, stimulate them with candles, or, as in the famous experiments with frogs' legs, submit leaves to electrical pulses to get a reaction. Electricity, touching, fire, chloroform. These are sensations we could imagine affecting a plant. But what about sound? The Desmodium gyrans is commonly known as the dancing plant, in the strict sense of the word.
If you make a noise, you'll see the leaves of this plant move incessantly. But you know, if you touch it instead of making a sound, it doesn't move at all. Actually, it's sound that it's sensitive to.
They like people to sing a song to them, They like to hear the nicely speech from the people, not from the artificial sound, like from electronic sound. They like to play with human.
So for us scientists, this is a great problem. For two reasons. Firstly, because we don't know how it works. Secondly, and this is perhaps worse, we don't know what it's for. I find this very curious. A plant that makes itself noticed by moving. A predator, a herbivore, a deer, or a horse, would see it more if it moved, rather than not moving. So there is a real mystery surrounding this plant. Surely in every
heart, then dreams have returned. The dancing plant seems to break all the rules. In the early 70s, at the beginning of the hippie movement, a crazy idea took root. Some people claim that music had a beneficial effect on plants. In doubtful but original experiments, plants were exposed to different styles of music. Jazz or classical music made them grow stronger, while rock music killed them. The musician Roger Roger even composed music specifically for plants. It was called Rhapsody in Green and was meant to help plants grow and bear fruit. While the dancing plant reacts to sound, the effect of different musical styles is not something that scientists take very seriously at all. Because science is about facts and supporting evidence. So, back on the crime scene, Van Hoven was searching for both. The pressure was on. The number of dead kudus was climbing. He had to solve this mystery. Van Hoven and his team of science detectives had two important clues. First, the deaths happened when kudus were in dense groups. And second, tannin was the killer, and that had to come from a plant. Their plan was to see if a plant could sense the presence of a dense number of animals. For the purpose of the experiment, they became a gang of ravenous kudus.
We then started looking at the tannin content of the same trees. We used acacias, several species of acacias, and we took the leaves, extracted the tannin, and measured the tannin content. And it was very clear that the tannin was up to four times higher on the ranches where there was a lot of browse, a lot of eating of the acacias. So that means the tree responds to overutilization, because the trees protect themselves. That's chemical defense. They don't want to be eaten all their leaves, because then they're gonna die.
The tree that everyone thought was saving the kudus' lives throughout the terrible drought turned out to be the killer. But another mystery soon emerged. Even the acacias, untouched by the kudus, had an increased concentration of tannin in their leaves. Van Hoven thought there might be something in the air.
First, we pulled off the leaves and opened up all the little pieces of the branches. So we put the bag over and left it there for about an hour. Then we took the bag off, and now we got the air in which there was also then release of gas from the plant itself. And we take a sample of this air, and that will be then analyzed back in the main lab.
What they quickly found was that as soon as kudus start overgrazing an acacia, the tree emitted a gas, ethylene.
Ethylene, when it is liberated out of these stems, it goes normally downwind because it's a very light gas, CH2, CH2. It's a small, colorless, odorless gas. But when it gets to other intact leaves, It affects the mitochondria, and the mitochondria then produces the enzymes that catalyze the production for more tannins. It's a chemical communication.
The mystery was solved. The acacia not only sensed the presence of large number of kudus, but their unseen communication system is what helped doom the large numbers of kudu grazing on the plants.
If you want to manage wildlife, look at the lessons that nature learns you, teaches you, and manage according to that.
Ranchers in the Limpopo savanna are now more respectful of the acacia, making sure that their properties are not overpopulated with kudu. Cases like the acacia have scientists now talking about plants having social skills. The oak is another example of trees acting as a community. They can perceive the space around them. If a sapling from another species tries to take root in their territory, the oaks launch a chemical attack, killing the young intruder. We see forests as places of peace and calm, yet they have a surprisingly active and dynamic social life. The way trees communicate is similar to some highly social insects, such as ants. They'll leave chemical trails for others to follow, creating an invisible highway. And when the colony is under attack, soldier ants will release formic acid to warn the others. When plants are stimulated by the outside world, their metabolism changes. And this information is communicated through chemistry.
A plant's going to react on nutrients that is transported by fluid, by water, through the root system. It's going to react on light, that is the stimulus for photosynthesis. And it's going to react on damage and infections. So if you've got damage by eating or infections by plant viruses, you break down plant tissues and the plants react on that. They immediately produce some kind of antibodies and they start reacting against that. It's in the human body, you find the same thing.
The chemistry that plants use to communicate is complex. Japan is in the forefront of this research.
Japanese people and Asian people in general have an insatiable curiosity for plants and animals, for all life around us. This is particularly true in Japan, where the feeling that we are part of nature is very strong.
Japan sees unlocking the secrets of the natural world as a source of innovation and prosperity for the future. The Laboratory of Plant Physiology at Tohoku University is well equipped to study the structural biochemistry of plants. They hope to find out how plants function at the molecular level. So far, they have achieved more than the Soviets ever did in the 1970s. Amongst their experiments, they are asking, how do plants sleep? Do they need sleep? And what happens if they don't? It's common to see these scientists taking their plants out for a morning stroll, moving their prize specimen from one artificial location to another.
This room is called the Artificial Climate Reproduction Room, where we recreate day and night in a 24-hour cycle. Here we have three plants on which we experiment with things like movement and sleep. These three plants are called Albizia, Senna, and Cassia. I'm currently working on this plant, the Cassia.
All animals and all plants and all organisms have a biological clock. That is common for all organisms. Thus, the sleep is not only the task of the animals. And some plants sleep very similar fashion as human beings. That is the leguminous plants.
It's 6 p.m. The light is fading. It's time to see how some plants sleep.
The Albizia, a plant of the leguminous family, folds its leaves at night. It sleeps. This leaf movement, which we call falling asleep, occurs over a 24-hour cycle. These leaves that are now open, because it's day, will close at night.
In the laboratory, Professor Minoru Ueda and his colleagues sometimes inflict a rather severe treatment on their plants. Leaves are cut, crushed, and ground to extract the molecule thought to be responsible for triggering sleep in plants.
First, I extract the plant's secretion. This process takes about a week. I then purify the extract using a centrifuge. I repeat this process several times. Finally, I end with a pure substance.
The plants are then subjected to the purified extracts and their reactions studied.
The results are the following. Here we've added potassium chelidonate, and here we've only added water. Where we've added potassium chelidonate, the plant closes itself down and its leaves are in a state of sleep. But where we've added water, the plants remain the same. Its leaves remain open. So we can actually see that the chemical substance controls the process of falling asleep.
They've found the key compound that the plant uses to tell itself that it's time to sleep. By using the same compound in a concentrated form, they can speed up the plant's reaction. What happens if you deny plants sleep? Could they be like us, needing sleep to regenerate their bodies and their minds?
If the natural process of sleep is prevented, then after 2 weeks the plant starts to turn yellow. It then withers and in the end, the plant dies. We cannot draw any conclusions. The experiment was inconclusive as to whether the plant died as a result of hygrometry dysfunction because its biological clock was disturbed. We still don't really understand why plants need sleep.
Experiments in Germany and Japan show that plants react to the outside world and communicate through chemistry. The acacia and oak have even used it to develop social skills. If we accept these abilities in plants, then we have to ask if plants have another essential criteria for intelligence, like memory, being able to retain and recall an event, and learn from it. If we take the case of the dancing plant, then there is little doubt that plants have memory.
If you take a dancing plant from the wild that's never had the opportunity to dance because it's too young or came from a quiet area and try to make it dance, then it doesn't do it very well. It moves a little bit, but clearly doesn't do what you'd like it to do. But then, train it to dance day after day, and you'll be surprised to find that day after day it will dance a little better, to the point where it becomes an exceptional ballerina, and it will stay that way. This plant is capable of something that sports people would call training, and that is based on memory.
In Germany, Professor Volkmann has found that pea seedlings have the capacity for memory.
Here we have two pea plants, and we like to investigate if they have a memory and how long this memory is lasting.
Professor Volkmann puts the seedlings in a horizontal position. Up is no longer up, but sideways. If the plants were left in this position, they would work out where up is and start growing in a new direction. The root system of some algae works in a similar way. The filaments responsible for keeping the plant in balance are transparent, so the effect can be clearly seen under the microscope. The trap granules are called statolites, and they are made up of minerals, and being heavier, tell the plant which way is down. We have a similar system in the ear to help us keep our balance. After 30 minutes, Professor Volkmann cools the seedlings down to 4 degrees Celsius, putting them in a suspended state of animation. He wants to see if they'll remember having been put on their sides. After several days, the young peas are taken out of the refrigerator and brought back to room temperature to wake up.
So, after warming up the temperature from 4 degrees in the refrigerator to 22 degrees in the laboratory, we see nicely the response of both plants. They know exactly where up and down was. They remember their stimulation before the weekend, so at least 4 to 5 days. And we see that the response is a little bit different between the two plants, which means the one is better with their remembrance, with their memory, than this one.
The experiment shows that plants have a perception and memory of the space around them. A dancing plant can be trained, building on previous experience. A carnivorous plant will retain the memory of a specific insect's touch for a short time in case another is nearby. The acacia will remember the kudu's overgrazing for over an hour. Plants have developed ways to store memory different to ours in a way that we don't as yet fully understand. It has allowed them to learn from the past, plan for the future, and work together for the benefit of the species.
The word memory has been used for many different systems. We speak of human memory and we speak of computer memory, which is not the same thing. We speak of memory for the inferior animals. In that case, it's yet another system. And we can even speak of memory for plants, as different authors and scientists have done. What we mean by memory is the capability to store a certain signal for a certain period of time, and in some experiments, the capability to recall that signal with another signal.
It's difficult for us to imagine that memory can be stored outside a brain. Could plants have some kind of central nervous system that we don't quite understand? And if so, where would it be? An audacious idea was proposed in the late 1800s. To understand its origins, we need to use our own memories and go back to where it started. Back to Victorian England and the great biologist Charles Darwin. Darwin's theories on the evolution of species revolutionized the field of biology and changed the way we look at our place in the animal kingdom. But Darwin's contribution to science was much more. In his country retreat in Kent, Darwin experimented on carnivorous and climbing plants. He put forth a daring idea that plant activity was not limited to growth.
Charles Darwin, in his book, speculated on the possibility of there being a root brain, because in Darwin's formulation, the brain was associated with bending movements of roots. We had discovered a special zone just behind the root tip, which seemed to suggest that this region has really some extraordinary physiology in there.
Charles Darwin turned the scientific community on its head, and his writings still resonate today. Darwin started with the fact that plants feed through their roots, just like the head of an animal. A plant's roots would act as a central nervous system. This is what we call root brains theory. The plant keeps its head in the ground and displays its sexual organs to the outside world. At Bonn University, František Beluska, an advocate of root brain theory, has been working for several years on the physiological functioning of roots.
Okay, so these are the seedlings in lung. Mm-hmm.
So the plants are extremely sensitive, although they don't look like to be sensitive, but even any small mechanical stimuli, immediately plants react. They initiate chemical, physical, and even electrical responses, and they screen continuously at least 20 different parameters from environment, and they need to integrate this information all the time in order to be able to adapt.
František Beluska has developed special techniques to observe and capture plants in action.
So, in the first movie, we will see a root with intact root cap. A root is growing up the slope with a swarm-like behavior, trying to find a weak place in the substrate. This is not just like very rapid movement. This whole sequence takes some 24 hours. And each this touchdown movement is in fact taking some 2-3 hours, during which the root apex is trying to grow down the gravity vector.
Under the camera, a root wriggles like a worm. But it's a different story when its cap is cut.
The second movie, we see two situations. The lower one is an intact root with a root cap, and the upper root is without root cap, and you will see very nicely that the upper root is not able to perform this worm-like behavior because it is lacking the root cap. The decapped root is growing even faster as a control root, but without any abilities to search for the weakest point, so it will grow just directly straight in line.
In the 1990s, researchers at the University of Bonn discovered unusual activity in a particular part of the root that they dubbed the zone of transition. Here they found cells containing molecules such as lactin and miosine. The fascinating thing about these molecules is that they are the same found in muscle cells that enable animals to move. The cells in the zone of transition may be very different, but they function in the same way as synapses, the nerve connections in animals that allow neurons in the brain to create circuits with other neurons, as well as muscle and gland cells. It's these synapse connections between cells that allow the complex interchange of information in our bodies, as well as perception, memory, and thought.
Plants know when to go to flowering or when to go to dormancy. These are very critical decisions for the plant, and the whole plant body must react simultaneously. So there must be some system, some central commander in the plant, which decides when to start this process.
Current research in plant physiology confirms Darwin's intuitions and ideas. The root system is not only used to feed, but it explores space with purpose and intelligence. The roots process complex information, much like the nervous system of vertebrates. If we look at how plants function and compare it to the animal world, it may not be as different as we'd like to think. If plants resemble us and have a kind of nervous system, then is it possible to talk about plant neurobiology? This is a gray area that some biologists enter without hesitation. In Slovakia, scientists from all over the world gather to attend a symposium. They are not many in their field, and none of them would want to miss this event. Minoru Ueda, Dieter Volkmann, and Franciszek Beluska all attend. They present their experiments and compare their views on a plant's nervous system.
Active natural products enables a new research.
The concept of neurobiology, like the concept of intelligence, means many things to many people. The contradictions and the conflict are very interesting and fun to listen to. Perhaps bearing more on the other researchers than on the plant neurobiology group.
20, 40, 60, 80, 20, 40.
These discussions are all part of a healthy debate that steers the scientists toward a greater insight into the world of plants. Scientists are quick to point out that plants do not have a brain or a nervous system. But at the same time, they will say that there are huge similarities at the structural and molecular levels with that of a vertebrate's nervous system. Cells may be very different, but they function very much like neurons and synapses that form circuits. The mechanics of how it's done may be different, but the results are almost identical. Plants need to perceive their environment and act intelligently to make the right choices in order to survive.
So we can say that the difference between plants and animals, or at least between plants and inferior animals, is not that big when you really look at the cellular and molecular levels.
These claims may seem reasonable, but the world of science is skeptic by nature.
These days it is, of course, difficult because this field is still not officially accepted. So the mainstream is still not convinced about this idea. So in science it is normal, it is just usual. Science is very conservative and it takes a lot of time to make really breakthrough changes and advances.
The journey of acceptance in science can sometimes be a long and arduous road. Fundamental research into plants can rattle conventional thinking. It sometimes embarrasses and disturbs. But it also opens our eyes and changes the way we look at the world of plants.
In the scientific world of plants, I am absolutely convinced that the greatest discoveries are yet to come.
We have much to learn from the natural world. The idea of plants having intelligence is a contradiction to our worldview. But at the same time, it is deeply consistent with the theory of evolution. All life has branched out from one center, rippling out, finding its own way to earn the right to live and pass on its genetic inheritance. What is true of animals is true of plants. There are superior plants, endowed with greater capability for perception, memory, and communication than others. In other words, with varying degrees of intelligent behavior. If we ask who is superior, animal or plant, then at least, in the Limpopo savanna, the answer is clear. The threatened acacia tree kills the starving kudu. And what if we went a little further and associated survival with intelligence? And we ask who will be around the longest? Then, the answer could be a little disconcerting.
Okay, and welcome to another tube time on the video about how to build a vacuum tube Tesla coil. Yes, I know it's been a while. Today we're going to talk about coils. Welcome to Tube Time on Cool Dude Clem's Electronic Workshop. I'm going to show you how to wind your own secondary, and also we're going to touch up on the basics of primaries. Now, it's pretty easy to wind your own primary. I mean, you just make a tube out of cardboard and then wrap some wire around it. There you go, primary. Except it's a little bit more complicated than that, so you might be wondering why you see two primaries here. Well, this one is for a solid state coil that I'm going to make, which is going to have phase lock loop, it's going to have audio modulation, I'm going to add an interrupter to it later, you know, it's going to have a whole lot, but that's for another video. And this coil is for the vacuum tube tester coil that is going to be the focus of this series. You may also be wondering why this coil only has a few turns of pretty thick wire, while this one has many turns of pretty thin wire. Again, that's because I'm matching the primary to the circuit that's going to drive it. For a solid state coil, you only need a few turns. This one's got about 11 turns, and this one's got about 44 turns. It's not actually critical the amount of turns you have, but generally, that's kind of in the ballpark for what you want for a solid state coil and a vacuum tube coil. So why does this one have fewer turns and this one have more turns? Well, it's because matching the coil to the device that's going to drive it. Now, solid-state drivers are low voltage and low impedance, so this one is going to have, you know, maybe 170 volts at the most going through it. Whereas one for a vacuum tube Tesla coil, yeah, this is going to have a few thousand volts going through it. And vacuum tubes are high voltage, high impedance devices, so need more turns. That way it's more matched to the device that's going to drive it. So this one is better for vacuum tube Tesla coils, and this one is better for solid-state Tesla coils. Also, if you don't have really thick wire to wind your solid-state primary, you can just use multi-core wire like I've used here. As you can see, it's... well, if the camera would focus on it, of course. This is 3-core cable that I've just twisted all the ends together. So the circuit's just going to see one piece of thick wire. And this one, although it looks like it's made from two separate windings, it's actually just one continuous winding because the wire I was using wasn't long enough, so I joined two pieces of wire together and that's how I wound that one. And now onto everybody's favourite part of making a Tesla coil, be it solid state, spark gap or tube, the secondary. Oh boy, this is why I've been holding back on this video. Now when it comes to winding your secondary, you're going to need something to wind the wire around, and for most people, a cardboard tube would suffice, but in many cases, cardboard is not really the best kind of thing to use. I've got a 2-inch diameter cardboard tube, and this really is not the best kind of thing to wind a secondary on, because for one thing, if we have a look really closely, you can see that the layers, instead of being nice and flat, they overlap, which is going to make the coil winding a little bit uneven, which is something you really don't want when you're winding a secondary. It doesn't matter so much for your primary, but you want your secondary to be nice and smooth. And of course, the other disadvantage with cardboard is, well, cardboard isn't all that strong, so as you're winding more and more and more turns on, that's going to compress the cardboard tube, and that's going to make the windings that you wound earlier become loose, and again, that's something you don't want. So this is pretty much out of the window. So what a lot of people use is plastic pipe. Now I know I said that black plastic pipe is not the best to use because some of them contain carbon to give it its black color, but PVC seems to be okay to use, and I've seen some people use that and have no problems with it. So that's what I'm using here, so we shouldn't have any problems with that. I had to get black because that's all they had, so that's what I'm gonna have to work with. So, next question is, where to get the wire? Well, you could send some money and get a reel of wire like this. Or you could harvest the wire out of old electronic components such as transformers and motors and things like that. And as a matter of fact, this secondary was made from the wire out of a transformer. And I'm going to do something pretty similar with this secondary. This thing here is the little coil off a shaded pole motor or induction motor or whatever you want to call it. And there's plenty of wire on there, and that's what I'm going to use to wind this secondary. I don't know how much it's going to cover, but let's find out. Okay, so now it's time to wind our secondary. And this is the part that I've really, really been dreading. I mean, really, really been dreading. Also, it looks as if this pipe was not cut entirely straight. That's the side that I cut, but the side that was actually cut at the factory doesn't seem to be cut that straight. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to make a line about a centimeter in. Sorry, I don't know what that is in inches. I'm just going to mark a line. And the reason I'm drawing this line is because I want to put some double-sided tape down at this end, and you'll see why in just a minute. But I want it to be nice and straight. So that's why I'm drawing this line. And then when I put the double-sided tape down, I'm just going to line up the edge of the tape with this line, and it'll be nice and straight. So there we go, the double-sided tape is on there nice and straight, so I'll just peel off the backing. And now I've got something to wind the first few turns onto. And anybody who's ever wound a secondary will tell you that those first few turns are always the most trickiest. So that tape's gonna hold them in nice and securely, and it's gonna make the job a lot easier. Okay, so we're almost ready to start winding wire onto this thing now. But first, I'm just gonna draw another line. And this is going to mark where my secondary is actually going to start. And the other thing about that is, I can use that line as a guide when I start winding the first few turns. So I can keep them nice and straight, I can line them up with that line, and we won't get a skewed coil. The double-sided tape is going to hold those first few turns nicely in place, and that's going to make the rest of it a lot easier. Okay, so let's wind a few windings on, trying to keep it lined up with the line that I drew. Doesn't matter if the first turn or so is not all that good, as long as the rest are okay. Also, you don't want the wire to break. If you break your wire, it's game over. You have to start all over again. So anyway, I'm going to wind the rest of the windings on. Now, you could put double-sided tape all along the thing, but I found that adds a little bit of space between the turns, and you don't really want that. You want the turns to be as close as possible, so just using a bit of tape for that first few turns or so is perfectly fine. Also, I'd like to take this opportunity to thank people who have donated to Cool Dude Clem's electronic workshop. I now have about 35 quid in my PayPal account, and I've just got to go and find somewhere now that accepts PayPal so I can get the parts for the next part of the video, such as the capacitors that I'm going to need. And also, this video here that you can see in the bottom corner of the screen, I've re-uploaded it and I've made it unlisted. So if you want to go and see that, just click on the link and you should be able to see it. Anyway, I'm going to continue winding this, and this is going to take pretty much forever, but let's see how this turns out. Alrighty then, wound a secondary. Took many months of hard labor and toil, but it's finally done. And I've still got a little bit of wire left on there. There's maybe even enough to make another coil. I don't know how well you can see it, but right here you can see where the double-sided tape ends because it kind of separates the turns a little bit. So they're not as closely packed together as they are along the rest of the secondary, and that's why I don't like to use double-sided tape along the whole tube. I learned that the hard way when I wound this one. I mean, you can see there's tons of bits where it's just been loosely wound because of the double-sided tape. But that secondary is still going to be good for things like solid-state tesla coils and things like that. Now, the only trouble is, I accidentally cut this a bit shorter than I wanted to. I finished winding it, but I just want to stick a bit on the end and then put a few loose turns on there, and then I'll have finished the secondary. The only thing that will be left after that is to... Oh, I've just lost my spooler wire. Wind my feedback onto the bottom of this, and it'll be done. Okay, so here is the completed secondary. I've glued that little bit on the end and made a few loose turns. And now, I want to wind on my feedback coil, which is going to be wound onto the bottom end of the secondary. So here it is. The finished secondary. Lovely. Okay, I'm not going to talk like that. So here we are. This is the finished secondary with the feedback winding wound onto the bottom, as you can see. That's about 15 turns, give or take. Doesn't have to be exact. I mean, I don't even know how many turns the actual secondary is, or even what gauge wire I've used. I'm just going to stick this in my VTTC and see how well it works. But first, I gotta test it. So we've got the bottom connection here, which is our feedback. And then right here is our ground. And at the top, the other end of the coil is connected to the breakout point. And I've gone and sealed where the wire comes out with hot glue so we won't get any... Hopefully, we shouldn't get any arcs coming out of the side of the wire where it's bent over going to the breakout point. And I'm going to use a very simple circuit to test this coil. Sorry for getting in the way. And ironically, despite the name of the circuit that I'm going to use to test the coil, it's really not all that exciting. Yes, I'm talking about the Slayer Exciter. It's a very simple circuit. It's just one transistor. A heatsink that's way overkill for this circuit, but that's what I happened to come across first in my parts books. A couple of diodes that can be thought of as one diode. And a resistor. And of course the two coils. So let's give this circuit a little bit of a test. I'm going to power this on 12 volts. It should be plenty enough to make the circuit do something. Alright, so I'm going to turn this on. Okay, so power is now on. So this should be generating high voltage, so I'm going to see if I can arc. Okay. Good, that appears to be working. Let's see. I'd say this is generating about 3,000 volts right now. And of course, when I use this in the vacuum tube tester coil, it's going to generate a whole lot more than that.
Oh, yeah.
We're there. Well, I'm gonna say that works, so... Now what we gotta do is we gotta find out the frequency that this thing is gonna operate at. Alright, okay, and here is how we're gonna do it. Now there are two ways we can do this, but it will require that you have either a frequency counter or an oscilloscope. There's just no two ways about it. You're gonna have to have either one or the other. This is a nice cheap meter that you can get, this multimeter. It's got a frequency counter built in and can measure up to about 10 megahertz, so that's gonna be... So that's well within what this circuit's gonna do. So, let's just power this up from this little battery here. So now it's oscillating. Now why I'm picking this up is that this meter is not actually connected to anything. I've just got one of the test leads hooked up on the wall there, and the other one is just dangling down onto the floor, so that's acting like an antenna, picking up the output from this coil. And the same pretty much goes for the scope. I just got a bit of wire stuffed into the input there, and that's just hooked up on the wall there to pick up the output from the coil. And the reason why I'm powering this off a battery is because I tried powering this off my homemade power supply, but the trace on the scope was really fuzzy and I couldn't really see what was going on. And it appears to be much cleaner if I power it off. Although the antenna is picking up a little bit too good, so that's actually, I've got that scope set on the maximum voltage right now, and already that's overdriving the scope's input, so I'm going to have to make that antenna shorter or move it further away. Alright, so I'm just going to move this way up there. So hopefully that'll pick up a bit less like that. But if you don't have a frequency counter like what I've got here, there's a way you can interpret what you see on the scope and get the frequency from that. Okay, now I know my scope isn't the most camera-friendly scope, so you'll just have to bear with me. I'm just going to turn up the backlight so we can see the divisions there, because I've had to turn the lights... I've had to turn all the lights out so it can see the scope screen, even though it looks perfectly visible in normal light, but... I'm just going to connect up the battery. Not battery. Battery. What we're going to do is we're going to measure the length of one cycle, which we're going to take it from there to there. Let's see how long that is. So that's one square, two squares, three squares. I'd say that's about 3.3 squares, or 3.3 divisions long. I don't know why my coil interferes with my microphone so much. At various points in the video, I might just as well have been going... For all you could hear of me... Okay, it's time to work this out now. And you're gonna need a calculator that has a lot of digits on it. So that's why I'm using the Windows calculator. Okay, so first what we need to do is put in the scope's time base, which in this case was 0.5 microseconds. And because it's microseconds, we divide that by 1,000,000. And then we multiply that by the amount of squares the waveform took up, or the amount of divisions the waveform took up, which in this case is 3.3. Then we just take the inverse of that. And there you go. It's that simple. There's the frequency, 606,060 hertz, which is close enough to what our God and the meter so were. And, you know, that's accurate enough, so, yeah. But wait, that's the resonant frequency we would get if I was to use this coil as my primary, which I'm not going to, because this is the coil I'm going to use as my primary, and all things are going to affect the secondary's resonant frequency. So let's see what the frequency is with this coil. And it's about 614 megahertz. So, not affected that much, but wait again! If we want streamers, we gotta take into account how they are going to affect the frequency, because they will. So, if I'm expecting, say, 4-inch streamers off this coil, all I gotta do is take a piece of wire about the same length as the streamer and just put that on like that. This is our substitute streamer, and let's see what the frequency is now. As you can see, it's dropped quite considerably. It is now 563 kilohertz. So I think I'm just going to round that off to 570 kilohertz, and that's the frequency I'm going to go for. Okay, so for the next part, you are going to need an inductance meter, because we're going to measure the inductance of the primary so we can work out what capacitor we need. And as you can see, 151 microhenry. Now the thing is, there is so much that can affect the inductance of the primary you would not believe. Bit like how the resonant frequency of the secondary can be affected by the primary you're using and the length of the sparks it makes. Also other things are going to affect it, like what you had for dinner last night, whether you're doing this on Venus or not. But anyway, this is with the secondary inserted and grounded, and as you can see, our primary's inductance is 151 microhenry. Now if I disconnect this from the ground, you'll see, now I've disconnected the secondary from the ground, the inductance has changed. And in fact, if I remove the secondary, it changes yet again. But since we're making a Tesla coil, which involves the secondary being inside the primary and grounded, we need to measure it like this. So now what we need to do is find the capacitor we need to tune the primary. Okay, so what we're going to do is use this online frequency calculator, and I'll put a link to this so you can use it for yourself, but I'm just going to set this up. I want the frequency in kilohertz, and I'm going to be working in nanofarads and microhenries. Okay, so we know a coil is about 150 microhenries. So let's see what happened if I put a 2.2 nanofarad capacitor. What will that give us? 277 kilohertz. So we need to go further than that. Right, okay, I've plugged in various different values, and turns out that the appropriate capacitor that I'm going to need is about 519 picofarads. And that's going to give me about 570 kilohertz, which is the frequency I agreed on earlier. So that's what we're going to do. Yeah, now I know what you're saying. There's no such thing as a 519 picofarad capacitor. Where am I going to get one of those? Well, you don't have to. You can do what I've done here. And I've put four capacitors in series. Each one of those is rated for 10,000 volts at 2.2 nanofarads. So when I put those all together, it's a little bit less than what I wanted, but it's close enough. Yeah, so the circuit's going to operate on a little bit higher frequency than what I wanted it to, but it's good enough. Anyway, it would be rude of me not to power this up and see what we get, so let's do that right now. Turn on, and let's see if it does anything. Well, I don't think there's much to worry about there. Now that was ballasted. Let's just turn out the light so we can see this a little better. That was at least shooting out 3-inch sparks, so that's really nice. Doesn't look as good on the camera for some reason. I think the sparks are a little bit too fast for the camera to capture, but let's just try it a little bit more. Right, now I'm just going to do a little bit of a temperature check on the capacitors, because these are not the ideal capacitors to use. You saw it worked, but let's just make sure that they don't get super hot. And they're a little bit warm, but let's do this full power. Alright, actually, just before I start the thing, there's no properties, the camera, I'm just adjusting my camera. because I have to do this while it's recording, although I think that's going to be alright. Alright, so... okay, so I've turned off the pesky autofocus, and now... okay, so I've turned off the pesky autofocus, so let's see how well it works. Awesome. Okay, now I'm just gonna do another short run, okay? Let's see. Alright, now I'm just gonna do that again. Just run it for a few seconds, see how hot the capacitors get. Yeah, they're only very slightly warm. But anyway, that's it for this video on how to build a vacuum tube Tesla coil. In the next video, we're going to get some better capacitors to use than these. And we're going to investigate into staccato controllers. And that will be the final video in the series, on how to build a vacuum tube Tesla coil. So, until next time, goodbye. Okay, and just before I go, here is the circuit for all to see. Now, rather than just draw this part along here, which is the actual circuit for the coil itself, I thought I'd include the power supply parts as well, just so you can see it all. And that's pretty much all there is to it. Now, if you watch my video on making a power supply, you see here this capacitor says 2 microfarads. Well, actually, that's 2 capacitors in parallel. Same with this capacitor here, that's 2 capacitors in parallel. And, as you probably know, this capacitor here was made from 4 capacitors in series. And, well, that's pretty much all there is to it. The Cool Dude Clem Vacuum Tube Tesla Coil.